Please, introduce yourself to the court.
My name is Chase Covington.
Where are you from, Ms. Covington?
Well, now I live in Midlands, but I'm originally from South Dakota.
What do you do for a living?
I am the chair of the Midlands Gambling Commission.
Where did you go to school?
I received my dual degree in economics and accounting from Sawyer College here in Midlands, and then I received my Juris Doctorate from Midlands State University.
And how did you become the chairperson of Midlands Gambling Commission?
Well, I realized that the position was open, so I decided to apply. I figured with my extensive job experience, I would be more than qualified.
You mentioned with your extensive job experience. What do you mean by that?
Well, after I passed the bar in 2000, I worked in a small law firm and then proceeded to work in the Department of Labor. After that, I was the Deputy State's Attorney General, and then proceeded to work in the Gaming Commission.
What are your responsibilities as the chair of Midlands Gambling Commission?
As the chair, two other members and I, we basically make sure that gambling is done openly, freely, and responsibly in Midlands. We are also in charge of revoking and issuing casino proposals.
Now, I want to direct your attention on October of 2014. Do you remember what was happening those days in your office?
Yes, of course. It was quite hectic. That was the day that the commission decided to announce that we'd be issuing a new casino license.
What did a person need to do in order to get the casino license?
Someone who wanted a new license would have to prepare a proposal, present it to myself and the other two members, and just basically pitch their ideas to us.
Did anyone express any interest?
Yes, there were two candidates.
Who were they?
The first was Mr. Avery Bancroft, and then Shannon Stark, along with her partner, J.C. Longstreet.
Did your responsibilities as the chair of Midlands Gambling Commission change after the department said that they were going to announce a proposal?
A little. The only thing that I had to do besides my regular duties were I had to be a little more available to the candidates if they wanted to meet in person, any email exchange, text messages, phone calls. I had to be there for them to give them my advice on their proposals and for them to pitch their ideas to me.
So you went over both of the proposals?
Yes, I did. It's my job.
What did you think about the proposal of Shannon Stark?
Ms. Stark's proposal was a much bigger project. It was very big and luxurious. It consisted of a lot more slots and space. The only issue I had with Ms. Stark's proposal is that this was her first business, and her business partner, J.C. Longstreet, had previously had a business here in Midlands that had just failed. So I was concerned how Ms. Stark would be able to maintain the business and not put the city at risk.
And what did you think about Avery Bancroft's proposal?
Mr. Bancroft's proposal was a lot smaller, but unlike Ms. Stark, he did have more experience in this, so I was a little more confident in that.
You mentioned before that your responsibilities changed. You had to meet with the people, the candidates, express interest. Did you meet with any of them?
Yes, I met with both candidates.
How many times did you meet with Shannon Stark?
I met with Ms. Stark twice.
How did those meetings go?
They went well, just regular meetings. The first meeting, Ms. Stark, it was just her and I, and we talked about her proposal. She presented her ideas to me. I gave her some advice on what she should change, and then she requested a second meeting so that her partner could be present. At that second meeting, we did essentially the same thing.
And you also said that you met with Avery Bancroft other two times, right?
That's correct.
When did you meet with Avery Bancroft?
I met with Mr. Bancroft April 13th and April 16th.
Now let's break down those two meetings. Let's talk about the April 13th meeting. Where did that take place?
This meeting took place in Mr. Bancroft's hotel and casino, the Black Bear. It was in room 312.
Who was there?
It was myself, my staffer, Mr. Mickey Keenan, Mr. Bancroft, and his assistant, Corey Guy.
What was discussed in this meeting?
Well, this meeting started off as a regular meeting. Mr. Bancroft was pitching his ideas to me. I was enjoying his proposal. But then my staffer, Mr. Keenan, quickly changed the subject of the conversation. He told Mr. Bancroft that he needed to do something to make everyone happy.
Objection to hearsay, Your Honor.
Your response?
Your Honor, this is not hearsay. This is not being offered to prove the truth of the matter asserted, but the effect on the listener. If I make an offer of proof, I can explain.
Okay. I'll overrule the objection.
Yes, Your Honor.
Was this meeting any different than the meetings that you had with Shannon Stark?
Yes, absolutely. After Mr. Keenan said that, Mr. Bancroft's whole demeanor completely changed. And then he proceeded to take a napkin and a pen and write $150,000 and slid it over to me.
Objection, Your Honor. Testifying facts, not evidence.
Your Honor, this witness doesn't have an affidavit, so she is able to testify on what she saw and heard that day.
For purposes of this competition, I'm going to overrule your objection. Okay?
Yes, Your Honor.
How did you react when Mickey Keenan handed you the napkin and the pen?
Well, when Mr. Bancroft handed me the napkin, I was pretty upset. I could not believe that Mr. Bancroft was being this unprofessional. It was completely ridiculous. I slid the napkin back to him and told him that he did not understand what kind of position this was putting me in.
And what happened next?
Mr. Bancroft clearly did not get the message because he proceeded to take the napkin again and the pen and wrote $250,000 and slid it back to me a second time.
How did you react that Mr. Bancroft increased the price with $100,000?
I thought that I needed to end this because clearly Mr. Bancroft was not getting that I did not want to be part of this, so I just took the napkin and put it in my pocket.
Let's talk about the second meeting that you had. Where did this meeting take place?
This meeting was supposed to take place in the exact same location at the Black Bear in room 312, but it did not happen.
It was supposed to take place, you mentioned. You didn't go to the meeting?
I did not. I did not, after the napkin situation, I did not want Mr. Bancroft to think that I was even considering this bribe situation, so I did not want to make it seem like I was, so I decided I would not go.
Did you meet with every Bancroft that day?
Yes, I did.
When?
I met with him right after the meeting around 2 p.m. in his casino.
What was discussed in this meeting?
Well, I wanted to tell Mr. Bancroft that although the napkin situation I was completely against, I was still going to vote for his proposal because he, unfortunately, aside from his moral situation, had the best proposal. And as the chair of the Midlands Gambling Commission, it is my job to pick the best proposal. But I wanted to make it very clear to him that I was not voting for him because of any kind of bribe.
Ms. Covington, on April 17, you had to make a decision. For whom casino proposal did you vote?
I voted for the best casino proposal, the one that would bring the most profit to the state, and that is Mr. Bancroft's.
No further questions.